Good morning and welcome to Restore Christian Church. Thank you for being with us this morning. We're so happy to have you and we can't wait till we all get together again. If you have your elements for communion, that would be a good time to grab those. I hope you enjoy the service and have a blessed day.
As we come to this next song, I would just like to read Galatians 5:1. For freedom, Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to yoke of slavery. In this song, it is proclaimed that there's freedom. There's freedom in His presence. A yoke of slavery is no more. We're free. We are set free. And victory is found in Jesus. Sing with us, this is found in you.
We're reaching out to welcome you. this place akin with your song. Flood our thoughts with wonder and awe. Give us a greater glimpse of never changing. Open wide, our hearts now to yours. Every fear bowed down to your love. That we would see like never before. Give us a greater glimpse of never changing.
Next song talks about how God is bigger, he is greater, he is mighty, that he does big things and that he's in control of everything. I know that sometimes that can seem really hard, that we can't necessarily trust it, just from all the things that our world has told us. And I just ask or challenge you during this song to really think about all of the areas of your life that seem really hard or seem too much to control or too, that are just a struggle. And I just challenge you to really give those to God, to spend this time, these next few minutes, just really surrendering that to him, because he is bigger, he is in control, he is mighty, and he's just amazing. So please join us in our next song.
Sickness, it must tell fear it has no place, it must go. You tell death it has no chance, it won't win. And if you are for me, God, what can come against? You are the one above it all, I stand.
Lord, I just thank you so much for your mightiness, for your greatness, and for just loving us, Lord. I just ask that you be with us as we listen to the message that Aaron is going to give. I pray that your wisdom and your knowledge, Holy Spirit, just come into him and just please just deliver the message that you want delivered to us today, Lord. I just thank you for your awesomeness, and again for your love and your grace, and that you are truly in control of everything, Lord. I just stand in awe and am so thankful, and we just love you, and in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Good morning, and welcome to the worship service of Restore Christian Church. For those of you who are watching, who are experiencing worship with us for the first time, my name is Aaron Kelso. I'm the lead planter and pastor of this community. And on behalf of all of us at Restore, we want you to know how grateful we are that you've chosen to worship with us this morning. Whether you're watching this or streaming this with us right now at our normal service time, or watching this sometime after, just the fact that you've made it to this point in the video tells me something very important about you. it reveals to me that on some level you're seeking God and see this time of worship as important. Sadly, many of us have used this time of social distancing to also distance ourselves from God. We have thousands of worship services to stream wherever and whenever, from our couch, or we could even listen to them in our car. And yet, I still hear people claiming to not have enough time in the week to watch but 5 minutes of one of these services. We have time. We do, church. It's just not a priority to some of us, which is a whole nother sermon for a whole other day. But I want to commend those of you who are watching, who are at least making an attempt to watch, and encourage you to continue to do so. This time is important. We need this time. We need to seek and be dependent upon God, something that tends to be very challenging for us as Americans. I think this concept of dependence is so difficult for us because our culture actively speaks otherwise. The two major hallmarks of our nation are freedom and independence. Ever since our forefathers first tossed off the yoke of British oppression, we the people have sought to establish a nation of total independence. We pride ourselves in it. We celebrate the self-made man or woman above all others. We instill the idea upon our children that they can be whatever they want or wish to be. We see personal accomplishments as the highest form of success. We even have this thing called the American Dream, an ideal that teaches anyone, regardless of where they're born or what class they're born into, can attain their own version of self-success and prosperity. People from around the world travel and move here to attain this fleeting hope. We love independence. We love it so much that dependence has become synonymous with weakness, and weakness with worthlessness. We love the sense of power and control it brings. Now, don't get me wrong. Freedom and independence are good ideals to have, but if elevated beyond what is healthy, they'll begin to work against us, to our detriment. There comes a point when dependence leads to the growth of pride, arrogance, and selfishness, something that has clearly taken root in our culture. We've forgotten that independence was gained and granted out of dependence. The Declaration of Independence was written by 5 men and signed by 56 total. They were men dependent upon one another. They would have never won independence on their own. It took 13 colonies with over 230,000 soldiers united in battle for 7 years just to be free. I know we don't like to hear it, but we need to. Hear me when I say this. There are things we can't do on our own. Things far beyond what little power or control we think we have. At times, dependence is necessary. We need to rely upon one another, and more importantly, our God in Christ. By nature, we're weak, we're flawed, and sinful, totally incapable of true freedom and goodness. Even if we don't recognize or accept this, we have a God who's known this from the beginning. It's the reason he sent his one and only Son to us in the form of Jesus, the Messiah. The Bible says, when Christ was among us, when he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. This world is corrupted and dangerous, and like sheep, we need a shepherd to come deliver, protect, and guide us to salvation. As Christians, people of faith, we have hope in that our shepherd has come. Amen. Our shepherd has come in God's great mercy by the incomparable grace of the Son and through the unmatched power of the Spirit. Eternal salvation has been made available and freely accessible to all people. What was once impossible, the forgiveness of sin, the changing of our nature, a relationship with our Creator, the ability to overcome, has been made possible through Jesus. The Bible says in the book of Isaiah, He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon Him was the chastisement that brought us peace. And with His wounds, we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. We have turned, every one of us, to our own way. And the Lord has laid on Him the iniquity of us all. He bore the sins of many and makes intercession for the transgressors. In His death and resurrection, Jesus did what we could never do: make total atonement for sin and give new life. True independence, freedom from sin, freedom from this world and all suffering is gained and granted out of dependence on God. As the Apostle Paul wrote in reflection of his own need of Christ, his own weaknesses and sin, he wrote, "Jesus said to me, 'My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in your weakness.'" Paul says, "Because of this, I boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. For the sake of Christ, then, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities. For when I am weak, then I am strong." There are things, church, we can't do on our own. Which brings us to the purpose of our study: to remind us of the power of Christ, that Jesus saves and secures, that He's able to do what we could never do, that we must depend upon Him. In Him is the power of total, eternal forgiveness and protection. He's the way, the truth, and the life, our intercessor who graciously provides access to God in life ever after, who freely gives all this and more, if only we would believe. I want us to remember and be encouraged as we study that Jesus does what we could never do, that He saves and secures, that in faith He grants us access to God in heaven forever. Say it with me: Jesus does what we can't do. Jesus does what we can't do. Give me an amen, church. Jesus does what we can't do. Now, if you missed the past few weeks, we are on the second to last message of our series, Seven Letters to Seven Churches, a study where we are going through the first three chapters of the book of Revelation, a section that contains seven short letters to seven different first century churches about their progress. They're letters written by the disciple John in the words of Jesus Himself about what each congregation is doing right and wrong, with a remedy to cure that wrong and a promise to follow. They're very practical letters that we as a new church have much to learn from. And so, with that being said, if you have your Bibles with you, go ahead and turn with me. If not, go ahead and follow along on the screen. But let's go ahead and begin in our passage for this morning. A letter to the church in Philadelphia, being Revelation chapter 3, verses 7 through 13. And Scripture states, starting in verse 7, "And to the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, the words of the Holy One, the true One, who has the key of David, who opens and no one will shut, who shuts and no one opens. So right off the bat, just like he's done in every other letter before, he starts with a description of himself from chapter 1. In chapter 1, specifically in Revelation chapter 1, verse 18, Jesus said that he is the first and the last, the living one, the one who died and is alive again, who has the keys of death and Hades. What this stresses is that Jesus has authority over life and death, to grant it, to take it, and anything else you can think of when it comes to life and death. Jesus has conquered sin and death and hell itself on the cross. And with that, he has the ability to send and to save. What's interesting, though, is in this reference, he takes out the reference to death and Hades and puts in David. Now, in the Old Testament, it's prophesied that through David would come the Messiah. So anytime we see the Son of David or anything in reference to David beyond himself as a person, we're referring to the Messiah. We're referring to this king that would come, that would reign forevermore. We know that person to be Jesus. And so Jesus says that he has the key of David, that he has authority, that he is the king. What's interesting is, as we're going to read through the rest of this letter, is that there's a lot of references to Judaism, to the synagogue, to the temple. And what we know is that the Christians were not welcome there in a lot of ways. They weren't welcome in the synagogues. The Jewish people were one of the chief persecutors of the Christian church early on. They saw it as, they saw it as a rival religion to their own. They saw it as some form of corruption, a cult, and they wanted to squash it out in a lot of ways. They wouldn't allow them access into the temple, into the city of God. And we're going to see here that Jesus has the keys of David, that he has authority over their temple, and one that's going to come, that every believer, no matter what race or ethnicity they come from, is going to be welcomed into. And so he says, the words of the Holy One, the true one, he holds the key of David, who opens, we're talking about a door here, and no one will shut, who shuts and no one opens. I know your works. Behold, I have set before you an open door, which no one is able to shut. I know that you have but little power, and yet you have kept my word and have not denied my name. What's interesting about this letter is that, unlike some of the other ones, well, unlike all the rest, I should say, there is nothing negative stated towards the church that's being addressed here. There is no condemnation towards the church of Philadelphia. There is only praise and encouragement here. And so he says, I know your works. I know that you do good things. But more importantly, I know that you have kept the faith. And for that, I want to encourage you and remind you that the door is open. And what this means is not only that Jesus gives us opportunity to come to him and to have relationship with God, but he makes the whole thing possible. He has authority. He opens the door. He's the one who opens it. No one else can open it. He can shut the door. No one else can shut it. He has control over those, or whether or not we have access to God. And it's through him that we have access to a relationship with God. It is through him that we have access to heaven. And so he encourages them with this. He says, I know you have little power. What I love about this verse, and we're going to talk a little bit more about it in just a little bit, but what this means is Jesus is calling them weak. He says, I know that you're weak, but you have faith. You have faith. And in your weakness, I have made you strong. It doesn't matter that you're weak, because I'm strong. It doesn't matter that you can't achieve these different things on your own. You're persevering. You're keeping the faith. And for that, I will provide the way. And you are not to worry about a thing. It says, behold, I will make those in the synagogue of Satan who say that they are Jews and are not, but lie. Behold, I will make them come and bow down before your feet, and they will learn that I have loved you. I love that, Jesus. Those who are persecuting you, those in the Jewish community who say that they are worshiping Yahweh, the same God as you, but are not, but are liars. The time is coming where they're going to not only fall down before me and reverence, but they're going to fall down before you and know that I love you. That's beautiful. And that's powerful. I think of Psalm 23 when David says something similar, when he's saying, you've prepared a feast, a table before me in the presence of my enemies. No one is going to harm them. Jesus is there for them. He's providing for them. And he's going to go as far as to protect them and celebrate them in their faith. Those who once beat them down will now be knelt down before them in reverence and recognition of their faith and Christ's love for them. He says, because you have kept my word about patient endurance. Anytime we see patient endurance in Scripture, it's always in relation to severe persecution, that they are patiently enduring hardships. I will keep you from the hour of trial that is coming on the whole world, to try those who dwell on the earth. I am coming soon. Hold fast what you have, so that no one seizes your crown. Throughout Scripture, we see this illustration of a crown. We see that a crown represents someone of faith. It's not necessarily a physical crown, but it's a sign of recognition that you belong to Christ, that you are worthy of a relationship with God. He says, your faith has made you worthy. I have presented you with this crown. Do not lose it in the midst of these trials and these persecutions. He says, the one who conquers, the one who prevails, the one who overcomes, who keeps the faith, he says, I will make him a pillar in the temple of my God. Never shall he go out of it. And I will write on him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, the new Jerusalem, which comes down from my God out of heaven, and my own new name. What an amazing image here. This is the first reference of the new Jerusalem, of the new heaven, new earth that John speaks more about later in chapter 21. But essentially what's going to happen in a nutshell here is Jesus is going to return. Everyone is going to be judged. And after that time, those of faith from all existence are going to be together with him again, but not in some heavenly realm, but here on earth. The Bible says that God is going to recreate creation. He's going to restore what was once lost. It's going to be just like it was in the beginning, but better. There's going to be a new Eden. A new place. The temple of God, John says, will be God himself. We will dwell in his presence. He will be our God and we will be his people forever. And so this whole world will be recreated. There'll be a new Jerusalem. There won't be any need for a temple. Nothing like that. But we will be in paradise with our Creator forever, just as he envisioned and wished at the beginning. And so Jesus, this is what you have to look forward to. You're not only going to have a crown. I'm going to write the name of God on you. You are a pillar. You are standing firm, and I will keep you and I will protect you. I'll not only give you salvation, but I'm going to keep you in that salvation and keep you safe and keep you secure forever. I'm going to write my name on you. You belong to me. And I to you. And so Jesus continues and he concludes with this. He who has an ear, let him hear. Once again, this is for everyone who's willing to hear this. And if anyone's willing to hear it, they need to hear it. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. I know your works. I know that you have but little power. And yet you have kept my word and have not denied my name. Behold, I have set before you an open door, which no one is able to shut. So hold fast what you have, for I am coming soon. It's apparent that the church in Philadelphia was one known for its weaknesses before men and its strength before God. Satan was working actively against them through many in the Jewish community. They were harassed and helpless, persecuted, looked down upon, and hated by others. But they had faith and were loved by Christ. They had and were constantly enduring patiently through all types of hardships and trials, and so are promised to be kept safe and secure from the coming judgment of the earth. As Jesus declared, "Because you have kept my word, I will keep you from the hour of trial that is coming." The believers in Philadelphia were dependent upon Christ and so are reminded that soon they'll be set free from their suffering. They're reminded that in Jesus there's power, that he saves and secures, that he's able to do what they could never do, that they are to depend upon him. As we read, these are the words of the Holy One, the true one, who has the key of David, who opens and no one will shut, who shuts and no one opens, who has set an open door before you, a door that leads to the presence and city of God, the New Jerusalem. They're given hope and encouragement by all Jesus is doing, will do, and is, and rightfully so. I mean, do you guys understand how amazing this is? What this meant for them and means for us? Sin has separated us from God, yes, but by faith, Jesus reunites us. Jesus is the Messiah, our salvation, our intercessor, our way to heaven, and a personal relationship with God. He holds the key we could never obtain, holds open the door we could never breach, and gives freely what we could never acquire. This illustration of Jesus likening himself to a door, a heavenly access way, is a common one. In the Sermon on the Mount, he said, "Seek and you will find, knock and the door will be opened to you." To the church in Laodicea that we'll read about next week, he said, "Here I am, I stand at the door waiting for you." And in the Gospel of John, he goes as far to say, "I am the gate." In other words, I'm the door. "Whoever enters through me will be saved. They will come in and go out and find what they need." What this tells us is that Jesus doesn't just hold the key. He is the key. He doesn't just open the door. He is the door. Jesus is everything. Every aspect of the illustration. Everything we need. He's the only way to truth and life, to God and heaven. You know, this letter to Philadelphia is the second longest, and yet it says hardly anything about the church in Philadelphia. All Jesus says about the church is that they're a weak and persecuted but faithful people. He says, "I know your works," and commands them to hold what they have, but gives no specifics as to what those things are. Why? I think it's to show us that although we play a role in our salvation, it is but a minor one. This letter is all about Jesus. It's about what he can do. It's about what he will do and what that means for those of faith. Look back with me, if you would, a moment in your Bibles, if you have them with you, and see how many times Jesus refers to himself in this letter. After his introduction, he uses the word "I" 10 times in only 5 verses, saying, "I know your works. I know that you have but little power, and yet you have kept my word. I have set before you an open door. I will make those of the synagogue of Satan come to you. I will make them bow down before your feet, and they will learn that I have loved you. I will keep you from the hour of trial, and I am coming soon. I will make you a pillar, and I will write on you the name of my God. Jesus does everything and asks only for faith, for the believers to continue to obey his commands. As one commentator wrote, their vindication, meaning their salvation, their justification before God, lies less in what they have done and more in what God has done. For he has loved them and given the life of his son for them. And thankfully, he's done the same for us. Amen? For us and our salvation, Jesus came down from heaven to suffer our death and make atonement for our sin, something we could never do. He has access to God in heaven and has authority to share it. He rose from the dead on the third day, defeated all sin and death, and through faith provides a way for us to follow, something we could never do. He was and is victorious. He has received the key, opened the heavenly door, and stands expectantly as he holds it open for us, something we can never do. There's so much we can't do, but there's also so much Jesus can do. Amen. No matter how independent or self-sufficient we may think we are, we must recognize our need to depend upon Christ. Now, I don't know where we're all at in our standing and our faith and relationship with God, but chances are most of us are trying to find access and open that door on our own. Trust me, church, there are way too many hurdles to jump over and barriers to break through for us to ever find access or open the door of salvation and security by ourselves. It's impossible. We're far too weak, have but little power, and therefore must trust and rely on another to get us to it and through it. So what is it? What is it that hinders or even keeps you from opening the door? Are you trying to push through on your own? Or are you going to walk through with Christ? Is it fear or doubt? Is it sin or addiction? Is it pride? What is it? What's stopping you from making a decision of faith right now? Wherever we're at this morning, I want us to understand there are things we cannot do on our own. I want us to ask God in faith to remove that which is holding us back. I want us to ask Him to increase our drive for dependence. I want us to remember that in Christ there's power, that Jesus saves and secures, that He's able to do what we could never do, that He's the one who graciously provides access to God and life ever after, who freely gives all this and more, only asking that we believe. The Bible promises this, church. In the Gospel of Matthew, Jesus said, "Ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks, receives. And the one who seeks, finds. And the one who knocks, it will be opened." Give it all to Jesus. Give it all to Jesus. Your life, your burdens, your sins. Give it all to Him. Have faith and be encouraged that He does even what we can't do. Would you bow with me? Father, I thank you so much for this message this morning, for this letter to the church in Philadelphia, for these words of encouragement, that even though we are weak, you make us strong. Even though we are lost, you are the one who finds. Jesus, you provide salvation. You provide security, relationship with God, and access to heaven forever. You do so much. And it seems almost impossible to understand why. Jesus, we know it's because of your great love, that it's because that you've loved us and that you continue to love us, all of us. Jesus, thank you for doing everything, for requiring only faith and obedience. God, I just pray on behalf of everyone who's watching right now. And I just pray if there are those who are trying to get there on their own, who are trying to overcome things on their own, or just trying to do life on their own, that they would just give it all to you, everything on their heart right now, and cry out to you and accept you. That you would welcome them into your kingdom. That you would write your name on them, give them that salvation, and secure them forever. Jesus, please forgive us for times where we so foolishly seek to be independent, totally independent. Help us to depend on you. Jesus, we need you. And we finally thank you again for doing what we can't do. In your name, we lift up all these things in prayer. Amen.
Hello, church. Kane here. Whether you're just visiting or you're one of our regular viewers, this is our communion time. We observe it every week. I don't know how you normally do it, but I've been able to experience it from many different aspects. I've had grandparents that from all denominations, and they did it different ways, but it's so important that I think it's good that we observe it every week. If you're like me, it's been kind of weird because of the pandemic and we haven't had a church setting. And so when you're sitting on your couch or whatever watching this video, it feels kind of awkward. And so I haven't really been prepared a lot of times with my juice and my bread or whatever. But that's okay. If you're like me and you're just sitting there, you can take this time really seriously. You can meditate and just focus on what the Lord has done for us. Because that's what it's all about, right? When Jesus was having what we call now the Lord's Supper with his disciples, he said, "Remember me." And at this time, you can take the emblems. If you don't, just close your eyes and just thank the Lord for what he did for us and the suffering, for all the things that we've done wrong and will do wrong. And we didn't deserve it, but he did it for us, and we're very grateful. And that is why this time is one of the most important and my favorite times of the service. If you have a short attention span like me, it's only a couple minutes, but you can really focus on the Lord. So again, this time, we just remember you, Lord. And if you feel comfortable, people that know me really well know that I really loved my grandma Kelso, and she always would talk about Jesus, and she'd say it out loud. And if you would with me this morning, if you feel like it, say, "Thank you, Jesus." Let me pray. Dear God, we just thank you so much. And we do remember you, Lord. Remember all the suffering and all the things you've done for us that we do not deserve, Lord. And at this time, Lord, we just want to focus on you and thank you. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you for joining us this week. As a reminder, if you want to give, you can do so online at restorechristianchurch.org or by mailing it to our P.O. Box, which is listed at 551 P.O. Box, Highland, Illinois at 62249. And don't forget to check out our Connect groups. They happen on Zoom Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday evenings. And if you have more questions, please comment below. That's all for announcements. And everybody, I hope you have a great week.